Good evening, everyone. Let's go ahead and call the meeting to order at this time. Please turn off all cell phones, electronic devices, the vibrator off at this time. Ms. Darlene, would you please lead us in our prayer and our pledge this evening there?
Our dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for the rain as we need it so bad. We ask, Lord, that you will guide and direct and keep our officers safe in this town, Lord. We ask that you will watch over our military. Keep them safe. We ask, Lord, that you will guide and direct us as we carry on the business for the city of Ballinger. In your precious name, amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thanks, Mr. Darlene. All right, consider approval of the minutes of the January 5th, 2017 meeting. Everybody had time to review.
I make a motion that we approve the minutes with just one correction.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All right, visitors who are not on the regular agenda will be given the opportunity to address the council on any subject at this time. Is anyone here or present that's not on the agenda this evening? You are?
Yes, sir.
All right. We can listen to what you have to say, but we're not allowed to discuss it or comment on it this time. Okay. It's not on the agenda, okay?
I'm Michael Jonas, and I live at 1202 North 9th, and I've been here before, but it's been a good while, and pretty much what I want to address is noise concern with the bass music up there. Got a neighbor that's been up there that's been doing this for quite some time, and probably 12, 13, 14 years, and part of 15, and it leveled off, and it's back again. So I'd like to have this dealt with, and you know, Mark McNulty, he was aware of the situation, aware of him concerning this, and so I've been told there's an ordinance on it, so I would like to have it implemented and have financial penalties put on this situation. So, you know, sometimes it's at midnight, sometimes 6:30 in the morning. So I can give more information to you if y'all want to call me, but I understand you don't want to discuss it right now, so this is my public comment.
What is the contact number for you?
365-5791.
Stan, you're aware of that?
Yes. I know Mr. Jonas. And of the situation with Mark, with his dealings with Chief McNulty, and I think it's been a while since we made contact or even got a call in that area. I'll have to go back and look and see, but you know, we can readdress it.
All right, thank you, Mr. Jonas. Appreciate you. All right, we're going to have a little change up in the agenda going forward. We're going to jump down to agenda item number 9 and hear a presentation of the new police officers and clerk to City Council by Interim Chief Stan Radish.
I just wanted to have y'all have the opportunity to meet all the new officers. We hired 4 new people in the past month and just want y'all to see them. First off, we have Miss Officer Suzanne Torres. She's been a reserve for us for a while now, and she's come on full time. Officer Chad Mercer, Timothy Mercer, he's come from Montgomery County with a little bit of experience, and Officer Justin Amaro, who's from Haskell, and freshly out of the academy and learning all the kinds of new stuff. So, and then we have our office personnel, Mark Reynolds, who has extensive office experience with dispatch and clerk, and she used to work for the Rums County Dispatch and Tongue County, and now she's back over here with us.
So, good morning, awesome. You guys here?
Yeah, thank you.
Awesome. See, the rest of y'all thought that you were, you know, gonna be rough tonight, that.
Are you from Haskell?
Yes, sir.
Originally?
Yes, sir.
Unfortunately.
I see that. You hear them? Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. Good to meet y'all. Things are going good.
I've heard good things about all three of you guys, and Stan speaks highly of you. Glad to have you on board.
Sir, thank you.
Thank y'all for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank y'all very much.
Appreciate you. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Y'all be careful.
Y'all go out that door.
You go that door?
Yeah.
Y'all, good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, then move along. We are removed from the table to discuss code enforcement issues. Have a motion to remove from the table to discuss code enforcement issues, please. So moved. Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All right, and I believe Mr. Nixon is going to address us on the things that are in your packet.
Okay, I like that everyone got a copy of a few of the things that I copied down. And I guess the crux of this is how much of this do we want to enforce? I mean, how do we want to enforce it? Ryan and I talked earlier. Our code book was published, I think, in the late last time. And it's pretty well behind on all new laws and state laws that come up lately. And so, you know, there are several things in here, such as no RVs parked on city streets, having all electricians, plumbers, register with the city before they do work. You know, no truck parking in residential areas. Do we want to do what this book currently says, or do we want to revamp a bunch of these? And, you know, there are several questions. RVs is really becoming an issue because we're getting a lot of them in town. Old ones, new ones, small ones, big ones. Should they be plumbed in or not be plumbed in?
So RVs are trailers.
Travel trailer. Yeah. Okay. There's a lot of things that, you know, I'm not sure about. Sure, how we want to address all this stuff.
We've talked about having somebody go through all of our code, somebody that does it for a living, you know, and get it all current. Do we have any idea?
We will have a proposal for you at the next council meeting on February 6th from Franklin Legal, and they're already looking at our code already. He told me who wrote it. Hasn't been updated in a while. He can give me a quote. We won't have to send him anything because he can pull. Is our entire code on our website?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And he can pull the whole thing from our website. What they will do is they will go through every bit of code and they will find things that conflict and contradict each other. So if chapter one conflict with chapter two, they will point that out, and then it'll be your decision to decide what the policy is going to be, or you can do away with them all and create a new policy. Typically, that service will cost $5,000 to $10,000, but Kirk could give me a quote. It may be less than that since he can already get the PDF out of it. That would be my recommendation. It would answer a lot of questions. The way this would work is Kirk would take it, he would look at it, he'd find everything, anything in our code that has been superseded by state statute, he'll automatically highlight and put to the side because that code is no longer enforceable. Anything that conflicts with each other, he'll talk to me and Steve and you got it through you guys, what do you want the code to be? Then he'll come back, he'll give you a complete version of what the code is for you to review and ultimately adopt. We'll have a hard copy of it like we do right now. We'll have a PDF version that we can put on our website as well as on his. And there's a number of, I mean, this isn't reinventing the wheel, so there's a number of policies throughout the state that we can adopt that are very similar to RVs. Do we let them plumb? What's the size for the grease trap? Do we let RVs on the street? Do we not let RVs on the street? And so my recommendation would be, clearly you've done a great job of bringing up some issues that we have. My recommendation would be to go with Kirk, or at least table this until we can get a quote. I was hoping to get one today, to get a quote from Kirk Franklin and then proceed from there. Because what he's brought up is probably just a hand, just a small, small number of larger issues that
we're going to. But Brian, prior to that, we're going to discuss the issue for recodification.
Yes, sir.
Because the RVs, that was put in 1959.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, there's some real nice travel trailers now and everything. If somebody's coming down for a family reunion, want to stay 2 or 3 days, I have no problem.
That's exactly the scenario that we talked about today.
Yeah, that's some of the things.
Well, alternatively, if you get a lot and put six of them on that lot and you start renting them out.
Well, I'm talking about city streets.
Yeah, right. But I mean, but right now it's kind of a free-for-all. I'm a firm believer that if you're going to have a code, it needs to be clear for our side of it, but the citizen side of it as well. And then you've got to have some of these things, there's no punishment. So Stan or Steve or somebody else can go out and get a problem with citation, and there's no punishment at the end of it.
Well, that's another question, Steve, that you brought up that I don't know about, but the code enforcement officer for the city, what authority do they have to issue citations and to issue? But that's not true in all cities, right?
Right.
I mean, some cities, the enforcement officer does have authority, and if we're going to do that, then what are the steps to
make
that happen?
Warhead probably needs to look at, but most of them I talk to that do issue citations, you know, that's through the county. We'll run through the power of council.
Okay. Steve, like their power comes through a certified letter, and that goes to municipal court, right?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, that's the extent of your power, is that right?
Yeah. Code enforcement has no key, right, unless it's through this county.
Unless the council adopts a code, but he's the one who would enforce that.
Right, I understand that.
Most of the time, the code enforcement officer falls under the purview of the police department.
Right.
And so the code enforcement officer would actually be a law. He's a licensed law enforcement officer. He can go issue a citation, and they're typically Class C's.
Yeah, I mean, I think the only thing you probably get up to, you know, illegal dumping or something, which is by the pound. And,
yeah. But you're typically, it's going to be a Class C misdemeanor. It's going to go to municipal court.
Right.
And so anything, the typical stuff you'll see, weeds, junk vehicles, all those are Class C misdemeanors, about $200 fine.
Yeah, it's set by the council.
Yeah.
I mean,
not to exceed.
Yeah, not to exceed $500. I think is the maximum for Class C.
Okay.
Well, see, that's another thing, too, just like the illegal dumping now. You know, it's changed recently with the book that you gave me the other day. You know.
Yeah.
There's a whole new set of laws now that governs the illegal dumping.
Right. That's getting big because there's so many people doing it.
Yeah.
I think as we started getting into some of these contradictions in the code, we've discovered there's more contradictions. It's, you ask a question, it produces two more questions. My recommendation to council, and I hate to table it again, but I think we'll have a lot more clarity on February 6th when we meet again. And we'll have a hard number to assess what the cost will be to fix it. The code book needs to be fixed. There's no issue there. There are certain sections that conflict with each other. There's certain subsections that conflict with each other. It's not clear. It's hard to enforce, and it's hard for our citizens to abide by the code, which I think makes a plausible argument when they go talk to Judge Little. we need to have a clear black and white definition of what a code violation is, and then we need to have a clear punishment for failing to meet that code.
Yeah, you're right about duplicity, because the next one there, the electricians and licensing, chapter 8, was also covered under chapter 10 also.
Yes. This code was written by Municipal Corporation of Florida, and it was done 10, 12 years ago. Might have been updated, I think the last update was 08, but this was a boilerplate code.
Yeah, we've updated certain sections of it over the last
year. Yeah, we've updated since I've been.
But we haven't taken it as a whole, we probably need to go through. I mean, because my issue is you can't tell somebody there's no RVs on the city streets if you've allowed somebody to have an RV on the city street. So you gotta have a policy.
The quick enforcement. And again, this is a rabbit trail we'll go down, but, you know, like Bob's point, Heather's parents come to see us for 3 days. Mm-hmm. They park on our harbor. Technically, that's a violation as it stands today.
Or not, yeah.
Yeah, I'm opposed to that. With your case, I might not be.
Well, if it's my in-laws, I'm definitely opposed to it. But so there, you know, you gotta have. I don't want to say exceptions, but you need to have some provisions in there.
It needs to be in the box.
So I agree. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah, and there's, you know, there's lots of things. It's almost endless, you know, just like grease traps.
There's
all restaurants are, you know, they're supposed to have a grease trap. What size? Nobody can tell me. No one can tell me. So the council has to set a 500 gallon grease trap. Everyone has to have one. And then they got to be maintained. Well, the international code kind of goes over that. But if they don't comply, what do you do? There's no enforcement.
If you don't have a fine, there's nothing going to happen.
Yeah. Well, and the new nursing home up here is one of the worst. You know. Well, now legally, we can shut the water off.
I think that's covered in the New Testament. That's good
for you. So there, you know, there needs to be a guideline, you know, for something.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Yeah. Nothing from the health department as far as specifying the size.
No.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Mm-hmm. Even the plumbers here in town, they don't know.
That's nuts.
But there have to be cities with policies.
Yes.
There's just got to be some standard code out there that we can find and just say.
I can, give me, in 30 minutes, I can find you about 30 different policies from various cities.
Well,
the thing we have to understand is, though, I think one of your questions is, I think whenever we make new code, we have to grandfather people that are already.
Yes.
Well, now that's true. Yeah. But now, just like in an instance of a restaurant.
Yeah.
Okay, now can you put in there, now this is effective this day, but everyone has to comply, so you have 6 months to comply.
Or alternatively, I like your other idea too, you know, you don't have to comply, but we're going to charge you $1,000 every time we come out and clean out that.
There you go.
Know, yeah. It's going to be cheaper.
Well, you know, we do.
I'm not saying I just made up $1,000.
Well, we use the sewer machine. Mm-hmm. All over the county.
Yeah.
And it never collected
that. He brings up another point. We had this issue a couple weeks ago where a restaurant had some blockage, and the plumber came out and says it's on the city side. But it wasn't on the city side. It was their service line to our tap.
Mm-hmm.
Now we went ahead and made the repair because we were right there and it was 2 feet worth of pipe. But technically, we're not supposed to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a question there. Is our service all the way to the tap? If you're on the sewer, is it all the way to the main? Or if you're on the water, is it all the way to the meter? if it's sewer and we got a, there's a street cut that has to be done to make a repair, do we charge them for that, or do we do that, or do we tell the plumber to come repair our street? I mean, those are the questions that you get into. And we can spend 3 or 4 hours going over the what ifs and the rat holes and everything.
So Steve, I was there when you inspected the grease trap and the Chinese restaurant. So what did you just determine that a grease trap?
We determined they had one, and they did.
Yes,
but now whether it's ever been cleaned out or not, I don't know.
How big was it?
It's pretty good.
I don't remember, sure.
Yeah,
it's pretty good. But it's inside the building in the floor.
It's in the kitchen. So Brian, you've been there and done that on many cities. The health department also mentions grit.
Grit.
G-R-I-T.
Oh, grit trap, yeah.
Now, if you don't, if you want to believe in grit, go through the car wash up there.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's...
The one out of the highway?
Yeah, V-Master. I don't know if it's been cleaned out in 6 months.
Well, it's shut down. I tried to wash my car. It's out of order.
But did you see what I'm talking about there? I assume that goes in there, sure not?
It, yes.
Well, it still pop up there. It always pops up.
And that's another good point. Everything, just because you don't see it, that means we have to take it over.
And that's not in the code, I'm sure.
I would be shocked.
Well, the only thing that stays is they gotta have one.
They have a grit trap? It's in there?
It's in there?
Yeah.
Really?
Grease and grit traps, they gotta have.
Okay.
Good, well, then consider me shocked.
Is that, well, car wash is covered on there?
Again, this is the rabbit hole we put in.
Well, that's the thing, the only time they ever clean it up, when it stops up.
I think we've seen it. Yeah.
Devoted entire meeting to that?
That's kind of all, that's what I want to make y'all aware of.
I think you bring a good point.
It's time to give you some ideas.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's hard for us to tell you to do the job if it's not real clear.
Right, well, it's to him.
It goes that way sometimes. Stan, you got something, you got anything you want?
No, besides, animal control, policy that's in there. It needs to be revamped as well. And some of the, I know there's a couple of, a section in there for policing, you know, sidewalk, walking on the sidewalk, stuff like that, that, you know, we need to look at, so.
That doesn't line up with what we have here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I mean, there's some sidewalks, there's no sidewalks, there's, you know, we gotta look at it and see, so. And of course, I'll, by all means, invite me out, I'll put in my two cents. And you can go get code with it.
I have no problem changing code. My plan to ban Hanson was, you ever heard No Dancing in Hanson? You ever seen the movie Footloose?
Yeah.
It's based off of Hanson, Texas. But they literally couldn't have a dance, and we had to issue a variance to have the senior prom. So I changed the ordinance to where you could have dancing. And I was... I didn't go to church for 2 weeks. Yeah. All right, motion to table code enforcement issues one more time, and we will have information from Franklin Legal at our next meeting.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All right. Well, we're going to go ahead and let's see if we can do this. Here, presentation by our fire department for the council to consider purchasing a ladder truck. We need a motion to table that at this time as well.
I'll make that motion.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All right, discuss and take action to consider helping the Ballinger Youth Sports to grub trees and dirt work on the soccer fields located on 13th Street. Who is the spokesperson this evening?
Yes, so.
Good evening. How are y'all doing?
Pretty good.
This is Larry Lancaster, president of Ballinger Youth Baseball Association. And then Cassie McNally, she's our treasurer. So.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Well, basically, what we're doing is trying to expand, I guess, the sports program and include soccer again.
Okay.
I'm sure y'all have seen the soccer fields and how these sit. So we've contacted the school and got permission to use the fields again. for that. We just need help clearing the fields, basically, just equipment-wise and, I guess, personnel too to help clear the fields. We're asking for assistance with that, so.
I talked to Scotty today, and I talked to Jeff Butts today. The easiest way to do this is to burn that field. The growth out there is incredibly bad. There are mesquites that are about this thick out there. Talking to Jeff today, the school had some liability issues and concerns about neighboring properties. And so they were adverse to us burning that down. Talked about putting a trench around it, burning everything in the middle. We would stand out there and watch it, have someone from the school stand out there and watch it. So that wasn't going to happen. So we are prepared to get, did you ever get a quote on the grubber, on the implement for the skid steer?
He didn't say anything to me about it.
We're trying to, we're going to get, the process would be we would grub it with the skid steer, which is not very big at all. But we would grub it with that, blade it, level it out, and get it prepared to take grass. It will be 5 to 6 weeks to get it all done. Even on top of that, we're still going to have to put grass. I told Stan today, I said, you know, any hope of trying to play on there in April or May is probably not going to happen.
We kind of have, like my idea of that is we have sections of it, like a spot where the smaller fields are, and then we have another section in the back that's actually been taken care of a little bit.
Okay.
And we can kind of, we're still planning to kind of try to still, you know, get soccer going, but use those smaller sections and use that for now, just have portable goals for the back part and, okay. And kind of, and then the, you know, the remaining, the big portion of it would have to be, of course, what kind of expect to be at least like next year or so.
From our end of it, any expectation to play in the spring is
especially on that portion.
That's not what happened.
Is that concession stand still up there?
Mm-hmm. It's still up there. Yes. It's actually in pretty decent shape.
Inhabited by
just
other critters.
Just clean and really honestly just trashed. I mean, this is the biggest thing in it. So just how it was left before. So
can we get dumpsters out there?
We have a dumpster.
We have one.
Yeah. No, I'm talking for the whole year.
Yeah, there is one dumpster. Mm-hmm.
There's a dumpster.
Okay. I think it's we don't have it dumped unless we call in or something.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's kind of a.
Isn't there two of them out there?
I think there's just the one by the in the back of the parking lot.
We have a bunch of little ones that we roll out during games or whatever, and then we dump them into the big one.
How versatile can we make these? In other words, if we wanted to take the soccer goals out and just have an open field and
we'll
market
football for next year.
Football, yes. Or kickball.
I hope so.
The whole thing with the goals, the permanent goals, I mean, they're already there. If you take those out, it's going to cost a lot to build movable goals and all that. And we do have, I mean, that was the whole plan for football and stuff, to be able to do it all up there. And we do have in the back section where the big soccer field used to be, like a larger soccer field that obviously there'll be no need for. I mean, we really won't have the kids to play soccer, and it's just not going to happen. Exactly. That has happened since I played soccer in high school years. So that would be something we could use. We could remove those goals and use that section for a football field, basically put in a little football field to use for that. Okay. And then even use that for it to be open so we could use it for a practice baseball field for baseball and everything else too. So that's kind of how I was looking at it. But the permanent goals that are there in the other spots, like for the under 6 field, the under 8 field, like an under 12 field, they're kind of, they'd probably be better to leave in place. So
what about the sprinkler system that's there?
It is, from what I've been told by the school, they were checking it out, it's pretty much trash. They had ran over something up there and busted the line, so they plugged it off. And what's left of it is, I mean, it's ancient. It was put in like in the early 80s or something. The mesquite's already grown through it. It's not even anything to worry about now. And that might be something eventually as the baseball session stuff, we'll have to look at putting a new sprinkler system in, but that's way down the line.
And for those of you who are unaware, the Ballinger Youth Baseball organization is reaching out to everybody in the public, and we're trying to do the Ballinger Youth Sports and include all different sports, and it'll have a completely and totally different board, but
that's where the soccer and hopefully basketball eventually, and well, I was working on basketball this year, and soccer and baseball and football.
And it includes like combining, we're trying to combine softball where it's all in one thing instead of.
So we'll only be getting up right our, the businesses in town once a year. Maybe they'll like us a lot more.
And hopefully that'll benefit us too, because we'll be bringing in, like with the basketball, especially we have people from surrounding towns. We even have teams from Cristobal that are wanting to play. We'll have winners teams, Eden. I mean, we have Bront for baseball sometimes. So hopefully the business will see that too and see that it's helping their business wise. Because everybody comes down for soccer on a Saturday or baseball on this day, they're going to stay around town and eat 90% of the time. So
when we did football, I'm sorry.
No, you're
we did football this fall. 400 people, 300 people,
a lot,
on Saturdays. And they all went to Beefmaster or Golden Chick or Walmart. And our sales tax number reflects that.
Yes.
And so, I mean, that's kind of the trade-off. You know, we can assist these this organization, and trade-off will be hopefully at the end of the rainbow is more sales tax for us.
Yeah.
I was telling Bob earlier this week, you know, last year my kiddo didn't have any of this.
Right.
And I think you was in the same boat. I spent 25 weekends in San Angelo, Texas, and I'm the city manager, and I'm taking my kid to Whataburger, and we're going to Walmart to buy something, and I'm getting a tank of gas over there. And it's nice from a convenience standpoint of not going to San Angelo. But it's also nice because when my mom or Heather's parents or whatever came into town, we're buying pizza, we're buying lunch. I'm watching Tech get the butt with. So I go buy scotch.
Our main goal
that part probably won't change.
Our main goal is to keep all of our registrations low, to include more kids, to include these more out-of-town teams. Cristobal wanted to play over here because we're almost a third of the cost for basketball. Mm-hmm. And we're not as competitive, I suppose, as the YMCA in San Angelo. So they wanted their kids to get to play and have fun. So that's what we're aiming for, and that's what we're shooting for. So
if I might take you down memory lane a little bit, and then at the end of this dialogue, I have a little bit of a suggestion. Larry, I refereed on those fields.
Mm-hmm.
I went and got my certification. Those were some good days. Fields were lined with parents, all ages of kids playing soccer. Dr. Stuka started a lot of this. He instructed Phil Sims and I one day to get my transit app, and we outlined the field right there. It is now a parking lot by the football field. That was once grass.
Mm-hmm.
That was our first soccer field. And then it progressed to this, and then the Ballinger Area Soccer Association. David Tower was big in the middle of that. They sold chocolate candy bars to finance everything.
Yeah, I played soccer on David's select team, actually.
I probably go with you. Probably red card.
Probably, I'm sure.
Anyway, Bonnie Clark donated that land, Larry, as you probably know. And then their agreement was their board made up of Coward and Don Higgins and a few others. They were going to wash them up. Well, at some point, it passed on to an heir. That heir inherited that land and wouldn't let the Soccer Association keep it and gave it to Sue for a huge tax rate. And we should know that. A huge tax. I sound like Trump, though. A big tax rate.
Yeah, it's huge.
Anyway, the school wouldn't back the Soccer Association. David Carrick went in the weight room, mop floor, just so he could stay in the school system to try to get that soccer thing, so he would have an in. And then with the coach at the time was strongly opposed to soccer. He wouldn't let any interscholastic competition occur.
Coach Slaughter?
That's exactly right. Totally opposed to it. We didn't finance $1,400.
Mm-hmm.
But David encouraged me today, Larry, before the city, Ryan, gets involved in this. He said, you better get a multi-year contract from the school. That's my throw out to you.
I did confirm with Jeff, the schools, they've got some sort of tax credit deed, and they're trying to get a full deed to it. You know, we can grub it, we can do those things, and I agree with you. Mm-hmm. There needs to be some things in place. An alternative that we've kicked around internally is trying to put a complex down in flats or by Indian Field. And so the concept of what y'all are doing is phenomenal and fantastic. I think Stan would agree if we got kids that are playing soccer, youth sports, they're not, you know, robbing 7-Eleven or whatever.
And that's I mean, athletic director now, Coach Butts and stuff is, and even Coach Butts, they're all, I mean, 100% for anything. I've talked to them, I had a meeting with them. I mean, they're on, like you said, it can change. I mean, obviously it's going to change eventually and have different people in, so it'd be awesome. And I mean, I definitely talked to them about some kind of agreement with the school for at least 3 to 5 years, something like that, to get started. I know we've talked even about the complex and stuff, and I think eventually down the road, if that was possible, I'm sure there's enough interest, and it'd be amazing to have, like, San Angelo has the rec that's kind of a city thing and stuff too. With the means and stuff of the city and all that, and I think even with it, it's in the long run, it's probably not going to cost a lot of money. I mean, because of the, you know, enrollments and stuff like that, it kind of pays for itself like we do. I mean, we have baseball, we have money in the bank to help, you know, fund that and buy. We just bought like a zero turn to help maintain everything and all that. So it would eventually, I mean, that'd be amazing to have it, something to do associated with the city. And hopefully the interest will kind of increase, and we're trying to, that's kind of part of it, we're trying to get the interest in it, because parents, I'm sure everybody knows, are pretty lazy nowadays and don't want to get involved, so that's kind of a big portion of the issue.
I said, why did it fail, David? He said, parents.
Yeah.
He said, there's a bunch of kids there. Nobody would call the sidelines, nobody wanted to rip out of you. Nobody wanted to work the concessions. That was a single answer, apparently.
I've got an answer to that, Bob. Every single council member has their own team. Every school board member has their own team.
I already have a basketball team.
Well, there you go, you already have. And so the school board teams can play the city council teams.
Let's do football. No, let's do football. Anyway, I appreciate your enthusiasm. I support you 100%. So.
Yeah, I've
played. What's that little catch?
Yeah, I played soccer with Coach Coward forever. So.
Did you really?
Yeah, until I was 18, we played.
Yeah, you remember all the little people.
We played all the way out in Colorado, like different places. We got into the high school for a little while. I actually played it wasn't as a UIL sport, but as a club sport. Where we could play other teams, play central and stuff like that. So, and it probably won't ever, soccer won't ever get that big, but hopefully everything else, the basketball, the football, the flag football, everything benefits, of course, the high school as well too. It's kind of the coach and Mr. Butts' idea. So that's their idea to help. Because other towns we've had that. I mean, towns we play sports against, Wall and places like that, it starts when, you know, the kids are small and goes all the way up in all those sports. So, and we just don't have that here. At all, I don't know where we're at.
There's a lot of kids that go to Angelo for soccer.
Yeah, even soccer, yeah. There's several soccer teams that we have, some that try to practice some little areas we do have cleared and then play in Angelo. So.
Larry, the backfield was, you remember, was the large stuff.
Yeah, that's the one I played.
It still, if you want to reuse that, it still has the middle
corner. The post.
Post driven in as markers for the sidelines and the center line. Yeah. They're still there. If you want to utilize those, try to find them with a metal detector.
Yeah.
And he said that, and I'm sure you know this, the barn's still full of all the equipment, or it should be.
Well, that's actually, I looked for that the other day. It's not there any longer.
Really? So
I'm not sure what happened to it. From my understanding, it was something to do with the school. Gave it to someone. Yeah, it's all gone.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's something we're definitely going to have to purchase as our soccer association, so everything gets going. So.
Candy bars.
Yeah.
I like candy bars.
They like you. All right. Motion to consider helping Ballinger Youth Sports to grub trees and dirt work on the soccer field located at 13th Street. Motion, please.
I'll make that motion.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Thank you.
We're going to ignore the multi-year contract.
No, I think we need to go address that.
Yes.
Will you amend that motion, Mr. Mayor?
Is that something the school's going to have to do?
Yes.
School's probably, that's not city property.
Yes.
Then we're going to get involved with that multi-year contract with them, with the school. Is my question, sir.
All right, Bobby, we're going
to invest in equipment and manpower to go out there and do all the work and not have a contract with the school through them.
No, there is an investment by us helping the youth sports.
What Bob's saying is, yes, before we agree to grub that, to clear all that off, mm-hmm, would it be worth our while, would the school be open to a 10-year agreement to allow them to play soccer in the field?
Or whatever sports they
decide. Or whatever sport.
And it's still kind of that field up there, that land is a mess like right now still. The school's actually working on getting a new deed and everything done. It's all, because like you said, the air changed and all that, and we have the baseball field up there right now, and then we use the high school baseball field, which is kind of never an issue. We always use the high school baseball field, so I definitely understand. I mean, I'm sure there wouldn't be a problem getting some kind of agreement from them.
You know,
I really don't think
that. I mean, right now we have an agreement with the baseball field,
yeah,
using the fields.
As far as the baseball field, because the baseball field is, the smaller baseball field, I mean, we only use, the high school obviously doesn't use it, it's just us. And we never had any issues. I mean, we
that's not part of that sound.
It's all part of
it.
It's
part of the bus. Yeah. I bet you Brian Dad working on that.
Yeah. All that's included together.
I just don't let it bother me.
I mean, I would hate to just restrict the argument to soccer and like it to be just versatile, open.
Well,
I mean, you know, if they want to play football on there, then they can play football, or if they want to do a kickball tournament.
Well, but I mean, if there's going to be a Ballinger Youth Sports Association, if that's what we're going to call it, some type of contractual arrangement. Y'all have one for the baseball field, right?
Yes.
Some type of contractual arrangement for that other land. I think it's worth asking that question before. I mean, because it's not that I think Bucks would ever do anything, but what about the next superintendent?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or what about the one after?
But
yeah,
it needs to come from the association.
Yeah, it's going to have to be something we're going to have to do with them and get agreement on.
Yeah.
They won't be
14, 13. I can call Coach Jones and have him and Coach Bucks meet with me anytime, really. It's pretty, I mean, I've done it on the same day to me and talk to him, so.
Well, that's what happened to him before. They basically, I think, got booted off the land. So you invest a lot of city money in this project, which I 100% endorse. And then 2 years from now, somebody changes their mind about that. Without it being a firm contract, I have a problem with that.
What's the punishment?
Punishment?
Well, if we, I mean.
There's no punishment. You just don't have a land anymore to use.
That's what I'm talking about. We go out there, I mean, the whole purpose is that we're gonna do, the quid pro quo is we're gonna go out there and put manpower, and I agree with you, but we're going to spend resources fixing it up. And we still have an agreement with them in 2 years, for 10 years, or whatever the case may be. And in 2020, they pull the rug out. What's our recourse?
It still would be the same.
And it is a thing the school board voted on. It's not just Coach Butt.
No, it's
the school, it's the whole school board voted on. They did vote and approve it. So.
Did y'all ever proceed to do a contract with them as far as from the league?
No, we didn't pursue any kind of contract as far as just the land. I mean, it was just talking to them, and they took it. Mr. Butts and Coach Jones actually took it to the school board and talked to them and kind of pushed it and got it approved. So.
What we might run into, the complexity I'm sitting here thinking, Bob, is if there are not clear deeds to that land, the school board will never enter a multi-year contract. They can't guarantee that something legally wouldn't happen. Well, I just think there were issues.
It's still an issue. Yeah, still, they're working with lawyers right now. They're trying to get it all
straightened out. You got tax credit.
Right, but I think there were still some issues because I can remember back when that happened, we tried to contest it, that it wasn't valid because there was something about that Bonnie put in there, that if it was used for these purposes, they couldn't, I'm just going off of a 10-year-old memory,
right. Mm-hmm.
that they couldn't take it away, or they couldn't move it, and so that there was some contested issues. And
yeah, that's my understanding. It was written, I mean, in the whole, when they donated or whatever, that it had to be used for youth sports.
Yeah,
and
right.
Like even the high school baseball field, that's why the school's working on it big time, because they, you know, if it doesn't turn out right, they don't get it fixed, and they could essentially lose the high school baseball field that they spend $15,000-$20,000 on a year. So I don't see them having any issues with it eventually, but it's, I mean, definitely a possibility. You never know who is going to be in that position.
Do you want to make our participation contingent upon clear title?
Yeah, that, and you know, 5 years would be fine with me.
Well, they're not going to, I don't think they're going to clear this legal issue up for a while.
It's been going on a while already.
Yeah.
But you don't know for sure.
Well, I think I looked up the deed, and the deed still states somebody else and not the high school.
Yeah, it's not even finalized.
Someone else's property, but we're still using it.
Yeah, it's been that way for years.
Yeah.
And it's never been a problem, so it's never been looked into, I guess, but now they're trying to put it on.
Technically, yes, it is.
Well, there is some risk there, so, I mean, I'd have to think about what's our investment in that?
Skid steering manpower.
Skid steering manpower, how many days?
Let's just say 6 weeks, 5 days, 30 days. I mean, what's skid steer?
Well, if that.
$100 an hour?
No, not a little, around 60. If the, if the skid steer is big enough, if not, we have to use the dozer. Do it with a dozer, probably, how big is that?
Maybe 2 acres.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be good, and we.
Yeah.
You talking about grubbing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I know we've talked to, Russell Ballinger that does lane clearing and stuff like that about it, and so I've talked to him about it a little bit, and he said he could do it. Actually, it wouldn't take him much time at all. He said he could do a couple weekends and do it.
So if we do it a week, I'm not as worried about that.
If he was worried about the sprinkler system.
Yeah, exactly. And he was wanting to, he was charging us just for his equipment, like equipment and diesel was like $3,000 is what he was selling.
Yeah, it's not a huge investment as far as money goes.
So are you going to go on with another irrigation system? Because all the fields were irrigated.
We might have to eventually, but hopefully, initially, we're going to make sure that, you know, the interest stays and we have enough participation and have to do fundraisers and stuff for the money.
You're not supposed to get that grass growing.
Yeah.
The capital investment, let's just say it's $5,000, and I think that's going to be high.
Right.
That'd be tough, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Easy.
That's a week, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's labor, manpower, everything. Right. I said 5 to 6 weeks as we grubbed it with the skid steer, but if we're not concerned about the sprinkler system, then we can take the dozer out there and maintain and be done with it in about 10 days.
Yeah, probably.
If we were trying to preserve a sprinkler system, which it sounds like we're not preserving it anymore.
Yeah.
Well, if you're talking about $5,000, I'm willing to take the risk.
So just keep the motion as is?
Yep.
I'll second it. Yeah, we'll let that one.
We are motion.
All right, you do. Do we have a vote?
We are ready to.
He was asking to rescind it.
Rescind it, amend it.
Amend it.
Did we vote already?
What do you want to vote?
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Second.
Aye. Well, you're going to see that on the eye.
I was asking you what you were trying to. That's what I was asking. I didn't answer.
You got 2 minutes, you'll pick up your kid up for practice.
I know. That's why I'm going.
All right, consider approval of building permits. You should have two. They were tabled at the last meeting. And they should be in front of you. They're the same two. One is for Chad Hardy. The other one is for Mobility Set.
Massey?
Yeah.
Chad Hardy, I spoke with him the day after our meeting. His intent is to sell, that building. It still hasn't been affixed. So technically he can put it, he can load it up and haul it around. And I think y'all are in agreement, I don't see any issue with it being there. Like I said, he wants to sell it more than anything else. And if it's not there, it's probably going to be parked in his driveway. And it's probably better off there.
Yeah.
My recommendation for that would be passage. And then I would like to take the other one on a separate issue. That's okay.
All right, motion to accept Chad Hardy building permit for the pink building.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. All right, moving along, we have the next one is mobility sale. You should have the same documentation you had in previously. Actually also contacted TxDOT, and there should be an email included stating the fact, I believe where this is in the map is in the right way of, we have a representative mobility. Okay.
Well, I'm not aware of what's going on with TxDOT, so I'd like to know what's going on if, because that's going to affect.
Your site is in the TxDOT right way.
Okay, then this needs to be marked off, and then we need to either my company, knowing that I know that.
Mm-hmm.
And that was discussed the day.
Yeah.
But we're having TxDOT issues.
Mm-hmm.
TxDOT's rewriting the code. TxDOT is not approving any permits for any of our single cell sites. But I have talked to Reynolds County, so I can just go outside the county.
Outside the city?
Yeah, and we'll just build a bigger site.
Okay.
And so I'll just relay that to my people. Y'all just mark me off today.
You was table it or deny the permit or?
Deny the permit. I've got a check, but I'll just send it back to my guys.
Okay.
But I should be saying
that. You're fine.
But we'll. That was discussed the day that came in, so that was a possibility. Just deny the permit, and then we do a recycle. We'll call a recycle, and we'll just go. I'll go in the county, or we'll figure out another situation.
I mean, theoretically, there's no problem with power itself, only if it's in the DOT route.
Absolutely. I mean,
and if we approve it, and the DOT comes back, and we don't approve the next stuff, and then y'all come back to us and go, how can we approve it when we knew it's the DOT route?
Well, and I've dealt with DOT for lots of years, and I've never seen the issues that's going on in these towns. I've dealt with under the ground pipeline. I'm a landman, right-of-way guy, and never had issues. I've sat in these meetings, and I'm like, well, I don't think TxDOT knows what to do. But legislation's going on right now, so maybe that's all going to change. But I appreciate your time, and y'all just deny me, and then we'll figure out another way to get this done. No problems in the county, so we're gonna put up a cell site, so and it'll improve everybody's.
We're all for better infrastructure.
Well, and we would love to work with the city, but and not saying that no today, just down the road. So we appreciate y'all's information too.
All right, just for future reference. I did find in the code book that up in that area, and that's the neighborhood business, there's a 35-foot high limit.
So that was.
That's in the code book? Well, it may have been in your knowledge.
Can we get a code change real quick?
You may put a one in front of the three.
Thank y'all, Councilman.
Thank you, sir. Be careful. All right, motion to deny the mobile sale permit, please.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right.
All right, hold on a minute. I'm not.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
You got another one? We got more?
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Start at 2010 North 6th, that's me, is going to build a 14 by 24 foot deck.
How much?
Back of red nets.
How much did you say?
14 to 24. Tommy Chambers is going to move in a mobile home. It's a new one, brand new. 26 by 58 out on 1932 Hutchins. There's his park.
So it's one of his rentals, right?
No, it's going to be his.
He is on, okay.
From my office, but he's got a mobile home park out there already.
Stan and Gail Bickle, 602 Broadway, is going to add a utility room, 18 by 18. Jean and Carolyn Roberts, 608 North 15th. If y'all know, this is Gene over here. And he's the one, their house burnt, back in 7th and Country Club. Anyway, Gene is going to move in a wood frame home. It's going to be a 30 by 40 home up there on the block.
At the Country Club block?
Yes.
Awesome.
And, let's see.
You said 608 15th.
Well, did I say 15th?
Well, that's where our mail's going to, so we addressed it to that. But it's actually 701 Country Club Road. That's where we live.
That's where the location is, right?
Yeah, well, we changed the mail because we didn't know when we were going to get a home.
Yeah. Okay.
He can't ever give the Lord. He blessed us with a home. So we're waiting on this. We could have done a half move in, but we wait for the y'all to move and whether y'all were going to approve it or not. We done purchased the house and we done purchased the permit and we're just waiting on where y'all, you know, for y'all, whatever y'all decide that you want to do.
Okay, and Lisa and Richard Rossingall at 400 North 4th. They want to move in a 10 by 13 store building.
With some Mueller building.
Sure. I don't like cricket or look like me.
No, is that in the back of the house or the side of the house? Is that the back of the side where it's going?
No, oh, the side door.
I don't think so.
Yes. I think the only one that's questionable, looking at the code book, is that if you add a deck, you have to invite the council for dinner. That's on page 47.
I'm going to say it's an email.
I'm just kidding. Anyway, that's all right.
And all of those are on the setbacks and everything's good on the remainder of those.
I think if you build a deck, you got to build new furniture for the police department.
Motion to accept the remaining permits as presented by Mr. Nixon, please.
I'll make that motion.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right, good to see you again.
Thank you. We want to say we really appreciate you. I had asked Steve about bring me a couple of loads of cleachy, but I think y'all been having some truck problems, and he said he wasn't going to be able to do that. So, but we appreciate everything the city has done for us, and we hope to have a home and get a couple of months so we can feel like we're part of the city boundaries.
Thank you.
Hope to get you there soon.
Thank y'all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming in. All right, here the city administrator's bi-weekly report, please.
Okay, in your packet, you got a blueprint of what the proposed police department layout will look like. This is the building that used to be the church that's across the street from the sheriff's office, behind the tax office. And so I wanted to throw that out there. We're going to start trying to find carpet tiles to put down and then start building walls and cubes and everything else. You should have that in there.
Well, no, there's, this is a different one.
Okay. You revised.
No, I revised it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Every day I get a different idea.
Oh.
Okay. So.
I just keep sleeping. It's a whole lot easier on paper.
Yeah.
Well, all them changes cost you.
Not until you sign the contract.
I mean, this one I just basically moved an office around and I'm able to get more cubicle space, which in turn I can get another officer or two in there. So,
you put your office out the back door?
Yeah.
About to clean the skin.
Furthest away as possible.
Okay.
So, I got to be near the break room.
Garden donuts?
Yes.
How come donut shops never run out? So here's the new layout. The expenses, the major expenses will be carpet tile and flooring. The walls that need to be erected will be, they're going to be costly, but they'll be somewhat minimal. We'll have some sheetrock work that needs to be done. But I think it's going to be a nice facility. It's a needed upgrade considering where they're at. They're basically in a brick closet at the moment. And so the cost of the building, refresh my memory, was $50,000?
No. $5,000 for the building, $14,000 for foundation work. $19,000 is all it's in it right now.
Okay.
It was a good deal.
Mm-hmm. And besides the evidence room is going to be more, more costly because you're looking at cement walls.
Yes.
Vaulted door, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, which can come later. You know, my main concern is getting moved in quickly. Mm-hmm. And, we can always work on that evidence room.
Okay. So, I wanted to bring that to your attention. Got a letter today from the Texas Water Development Board. We have been recommended for funding for the what's called the PAD. This is for the water line from Phantom to Ballinger. We've been funded. The total project is a little over $3 million. $2 million of it is going to be a grant, and $1 million of it is going to be our commitment to the project. The interest rate is 0.93. So we're paying less than 1% money on it. The board will meet on the 26th of January, and so I will be in Austin for that. Anybody who wants to come with me is welcome to. And so that's where we are on that project. And then finally, good news, our sales tax is up. Did we get the collection today or did we get it Friday, Bob? Okay, we got it last week. We got a collection of $66,067.85. We are just under $350,000 for the fiscal year. We are roughly 16% ahead of where we were this time last year. And we still have the big month of February where we will collect the monthly, the quarterly, and the annual sales tax. And so if you look, February is a huge month for us, anywhere from 187,000 to, well, that was, we won't go down that way, 174,000 to as low as 150. So that'll be a nice sales tax reimbursement for us on that. We won't meet again until the 6th of February. I'd like to put this in your heads right now to have that meeting at noon, if at all possible. Me and I think Philip and maybe Arlene are going to the Texas Midwest Community Network Day at the Capitol on the 7th is when we're supposed to be there. Travel on the 6th, and so I would like to have the meeting moved to noon, if at all possible. It's also my daughter's last basketball game, Philip's daughter's last basketball game as well.
For the year,
selfishly. Other than that, that is all we have going on. We won't meet again until the 6th. Any questions? Anybody got anything for me? Any questions, Bob?
Well, I do. But I've been sure I've already covered. Can I say something that bothers me a little bit?
Sure.
This project up here on Broadway.
What project?
By Bickle. The never ending project across from the Mexican restaurant.
Right here.
Yeah.
By Acapulco?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that not to be discussed? It's just kind of an eyesore. It seems like it's stopped.
They got a building permit to do that. Oh, did we ever? I don't think we ever put a time frame on construction.
All building permits.
All what?
All building permits have time limits.
Yes, all of them are 6 months.
Okay. So without discussion, I can prod, we can prod them and use the resources that are available to us.
Doesn't look like much structural integrity is there, you know what I mean?
But the neighbors next door wouldn't do it.
Anyway, I apologize.
No, you're fine. You're fine. Anything else? We good?
All right, here request for future agenda items from City Council.
Well, everybody talking at once.
Everybody, I don't know, I just put this on yet. If we move it to noon on the 6th, is that going to cost anything at the moment? Okay.
Yes, what? Just, I'm just saying yes.
Yes? Does everybody else say no?
Yes.
I see how you are. So if we all say yes, you're going to say no?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
By that meeting though, we will have something kind of in hand to know about the code.
Yes.
I'll have the price and curb and everything else.
All right, Ballinger City Council meeting executive session is authorized by Texas Government Code Section 551.071 for personal matters, performance review, Stanley Murray, Chairman of the Chief of Police.
Thank you, Mr. Governor, executive session.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson, sir.